Anybody who has been watching me for a while may know that one of the things that I've always found fascinating is the development process of video games and unreleased or cut content from pre-release versions of said games. Beta content, if you will. A lot of my favorite games have very interesting development histories, along with a lot of unanswered questions and mysteries. That rhyme was completely by accident. Banjo-Kazooie was an RPG on the Super Nintendo and had Stop and Swap. Mario 64 had L is Real. Mother 3 was almost an N64 game. Earthworm Jim 3D was presumably going to be a halfway decent video game. And Ocarina of Time, well, I don't even know where to begin with this one. This game's beta is a treasure trove of mysteries and rabbit holes. Apparently, at one point, it might have been possible to obtain the Triforce. There was 64DD functionality. Link had all these crazy sword maneuvers, weird enemies, and mysterious locations which only existed in these very fuzzy, low-resolution videos taken at old gaming conferences. Sadly, the chances that any of us mere mortals have of experiencing the beta versions of any of these games is basically zero. Nintendo especially does not like the idea of people asking questions about their stuff or getting too curious or nosy, which is why when a bunch of beta levels leaked earlier this year, well, it was a pretty damn big deal. Some of you might remember that way back in January, a huge leak took place in which an avalanche of stuff, including a bunch of old map data from a pre-release version of Ocarina of Time, was made public. Although these map models were largely useless on their own, it didn't take long before a ragtag group of ROM hackers managed to actually port them into the vanilla game. Now you could explore this weird, never-before-played Twilight Zone version of Ocarina of Time, and it was very cool. Unfortunately, the levels didn't have any real functionality and were mostly just explorable 3D models, but a group of hackers led by one Zell or Zell640 on Twitter actually managed to rework these models into a playable version of the Space World 97 demo that otherwise only existed in our 1440p memories. Just to do a little research, I did some digging into the footage of Space World 97, and it's remarkable how many little details the modders picked up on. I assume that these videos and probably a couple of screenshots that were floating around were pretty much the only things they had to go on when making this hack. Although this is not a 100% accurate recreation by the team's own admission, the hack is still remarkably faithful, from what I can tell. Of course, there are some exceptions here and there, such as Link's voice for instance, but I imagine getting a decent quality rip of his old voice would be very difficult, especially based on these videos. As a side note, you gotta love how in almost every video of a guy recording a TV, you can hear another TV playing Banjo-Kazooie music. These games were being developed and unveiled to the public basically at the same time, so it's a funny thing to note. It really places you in that moment of history. Let's start with the most obvious thing, the audio-visual changes. If you saw the beta maps before, you already know a lot of textures are simpler and more colorful, perhaps more cartoonish and less realistic looking in some respects. It's clear that there was a bit of an internal debate as to what the art direction of this game was going to be. I mean, it's either that or they just figured the textures were good enough for development purposes. To be more in tune with the Space World build, though, this hack includes several visual changes in addition to that. For instance, the minimap on the bottom right corner is mostly a topographical blue thingy rather than the more simplistic and pragmatic blue thingy in the final game. Unless you're in a dungeon, but whatever. Orange sparks fly whenever your sword collides with an enemy shield. The targeting system looks different. Some of the sound effects have been altered. But definitely my favorite thing is these beta Octoroks. Look at them, they're so cute. I almost feel bad for stabbing them in the head. Almost. If you look closely at Link's hat, you may notice that it actually has physics now. I'm not sure why they decided to change that in the final game, but I'm sure Nintendo knows best. They would never sign off on a bad decision. I also noticed that when Link turns around, instead of having a jerky animation where he does a 180 in a single frame, there's actually a walking animation of him physically turning around before walking in that direction. Smooth animations like this were a lot more rare in these days, but I think I can understand why they changed it. Turning around feels a lot more stiff in this game, like there's a greater delay between the input and the action. It's kinda like how in Red Dead Redemption 2, the animations are ridiculously smooth and realistic, but actually playing the game feels like trying to steer a steampunk cowboy mech. It just doesn't feel good. I think in the end, Nintendo figured they needed to make a choice between smooth animations and better controls, and I think it was a good call to prioritize controls in the end. Looking at beta content is not just interesting because there's a bunch of shit that we didn't know previously and didn't get to see in the end, but also because it gives you insight into the development process of the game. You see what they changed, and in many situations you can probably get why they did that. I think the weirdest and certainly most frustrating thing about the beta version is that the A button is the sword button. It could honestly just be because the release version and every Zelda game since uses B, so any other button just feels weird no matter what. But otherwise, fundamentally, the sword play in the beta version is mostly the same, except now you can actually swing your sword while you're moving, kinda like in Twilight Princess. I almost wonder if they didn't include that because they figured it'd be too broken or something. Another interesting thing is the ability to jump on command. It's an interesting thing, but I guess it isn't particularly useful because jumping as an automatic context-sensitive action when you run at a ledge honestly works perfectly fine on its own. One detail that I definitely like is the fact that the shield is actually an active physical hitbox, which is to say that if a hazard or an enemy hits your shield, even if you're not actively holding it up with the R button, it still protects you from the elements, which is really cool. Cool as shit, almost. And speaking of cool, one of the coolest places in this hack has to be the original Deku Tree, because it's probably one of the most fleshed out areas. It is designed like an actual dungeon where you have to actually do something in order to push your way through to the end. The Dodongo Cavern is very similar. It's familiar to the final version, but has more than its share of surprises and differences that anyone who's familiar with the actual game will probably catch on to. Another one of my favorite areas in this pre-release version is the Lost Woods. You have all of these beta enemies that didn't end up in the final game, like these jelly blobs who I think are supposed to be choo-choos or something. You got these more cartoonish and funny looking Mr. Bones looking ass Stalfos and these tiny moblins who are about the same size as you. Although this mod is chiefly for recreating some of the moments seen at Space World 97 specifically, it also contains the classic debug level select screen where other worlds that weren't necessarily shown at Space World have been brushed up with their own new functionalities. They aren't quite as fleshed out as the actual Space World moments, but they didn't have nearly as much information to go on, so that makes sense. There are also a few of these pre-rendered 2D rooms which we've never seen before, like this one, which I think is supposed to be the Hylian Castle. The archery range is now a tiny bit more lively, there's this old Hyrule field with nothing really in it, there's a slightly less old Hyrule field with slightly more in it, but still basically nothing. You got this old Kokiri forest that's been repopulated with the residents from the final game. This old Ganon's Tower looking place with these old Stalfos and this golden armor guy who just fucking annihilates you. Honestly, this hack is very special. It is a remarkable attempt to recreate an experience that we otherwise probably never would have had. I will say that even though it was cool to see what never came to be, it also made me gain a new appreciation for the actual released game and all the changes therein. Although a lot of the stuff that was left out was definitely cool, I think the changes were a net positive. But because of this ROM hack, we can see some of what almost was. It's a win-win in my book. So yes, I would recommend this one. That's it for today's video, but tune in tomorrow around 2:30 to see what our next present is. I won't spoil it for you, but rest assured that people who value their hygiene will really appreciate this next one.